2017. It is. Is there any declaration of interest?
No.
Okay. Minutes of the last meeting of the 11th of October. Shall we go to page by page if anyone's got any comments or observations covered elsewhere? Page 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Are you all content? Are you content for me to sign them? Agenda item 3, LGPS update. Move on.
These reports cover the LGPS update has taken to the last two pension committee meetings. The November report highlights that the executive legislation has been subject to delays. We understand that the recovery legislation for UK and 80,000 for the same public sector within a year is due to come into force. It could be early this year, but still haven't seen any regulations. Although the enterprise at commencement calls was issued by the Treasury beginning of February, and this is the primary legislation to enable the government to make further regulations to implement the £25,000 cap. A consultation on the draft regulations will be required, but there's no targeted implementation dates as yet, but the secondary legislation is still being finalised in consultation. So, you know, I can't give you a fair implementation date that further consultation is due on proposals for standard exit payments across the public sector. I understand that scheme advisory boards are discussing how LG should respond to the Treasury proposals, but they've unfortunately missed the 26th of December deadline for responses due to complexity around communicating multiple to Washington to members. And I understand that these regulations which are going to limit the exit payments are going to have more of an impact on LG than the 95 cash. Because if you looked at the consultation documents for the consultation around consistency across the public sector, it actually said there was only out of public exits in 14-15, 95% of them were less than the 95% cap, £95,000 cap. So I would imagine that these further regulations limiting exit payments are going to raise the impact on more people in the LGPS than the 95k cap. The report also raises awareness of the government's initiative for members who have gaps in their national insurance records to pay subsidised voluntary contributions to boost state pension. This is really going to be relevant for members who are in receipt of the LGPS pension before the state pension and they're not in employment, so there may be opportunities to pay additional national insurance so that they can retain a full state pension. There is a simple example on page 16 of the benefits of taking up the option, although in reality it's really complex for members to assess whether they qualify for the scheme, as it depends on whether you build a pension up under the old or the new system, and what gaps in national insurance history can be purchased is really difficult to determine. I know I had one of your pensioners sent quite a number of emails to me around the scheme, and it was difficult to try and explain to him what he could actually purchase. I think the limitation is you can go back for 6 years. If you've got a gap, you can go back if it's in relation to 6 years previous national insurance, you can purchase that. There are some other, it depends on when you're born, there's some further dates that you can go back, but I can't even remember the dates now. But grant, if you're born in the 50s, you can go back there in the 6 years. But it's really complicated, and we've got a link on the fund website to DWP information on this.
That's the contact point for that, isn't it?
Sorry.
Is that the contact
point? Yeah, the DWP. We've given them information, we have put LGA is now printed. It's quite a simple guide, but it does direct do have a dozen trees that are affected with the UK.
I can report on that member of yours. I think he's managed to get all the information he was requesting directly, so he seemed to be satisfied.
Because he did respond back before
he couldn't give any information, he had to get it back.
Yeah, I gave him a call given, but I didn't know what his national insurance contribution district was, so I don't know if he needs WP, he needs to go onto that site.
I think we're sorted on that.
The January update raises awareness of the publication of two government consultations. One was on equalisation and deputation of GMPs and the other on pension scams. I shared the funds, got responses to the consultations with both the chair of the pension committee and the board, and I included John's useful comments in the final submissions, and I have circular copies. They are saying his copies are in the office now, but John was very helpful in the comments and provided to me, and I did, we did amend all the funds before we spent. But the fund response to the GMP consultation focused on the necessity for simple administration approach to promote member understanding and outlines of fund prepared approach to convert GMPs into scheme benefits. The trade off for the simplicity is that employers will face increased costs. As the loss of indexation is a direct consequence of state reform, the funds have made the point that that additional funds should be made available to offset the extra liability on employers. I don't know, I'm not really hopeful for that coming through, but I did make the point. The fund supports the government measures to tap out the areas of pension scams by banning pill calling, limiting the statutory right to transfer, and making it harder to open fraudulent schemes. The focus of the fund response highlights the need for robust HMRC and statutory controls, protecting members of pension funds from penal tax charges. The report also shows a comparison of evaluation funds and position and the staff standardised funds and approach. Evaluation funds and level is 86% and the staff funds and level is, as you can see, a lot higher than 98%. And the main driver for the difference is the discount rate, staff's being more optimistic. Although the fund's liabilities do allow for short-term pay restraint, which partially offsets the difference in the discount rate.
Good. Yvonne, there's quite a few changes there that we're anticipating. Do you involve, anticipate an awful lot of work coming through to the department? Because clearly there's going to be an awful lot of pensioners who are confused about these changes.
Yeah.
And they're going to start coming through fairly quickly, and it's just whether, first of all, we've anticipated that, and whether what sort of workload that might be.
Well, as we've said, it's difficult because we don't know when the actual regulations are going to come through, but I do expect there'll be some time this year. And once we get a feel of the draft regulations and the interaction with the LGPS regulations, we'll have more of an idea of how much it's going to impact. But yeah, I'm sure we're going to have lots of interest from all members. Because, as we know, with local authorities, they're going to be waiting for instruction, and there's lots of redundancies coming up. So people are obviously fearful of the impact it's going to have on their pension benefits and whether to agree to put themselves forward for redundancy, because they don't know what the impact's going to be on the financial the pension, if they don't know if they're going to get reduced benefits or not, how to impact on them.
This whole national insurance issue. Most people spent years in the scheme, contracted out, and in a sense didn't have to worry because you just got a flat basic state pension, that's what anyone expected.
Yeah.
Now we've gone to this new flat rate scheme, which is higher, but a lot of people aren't going to be anywhere near that. I mean, I don't know if this is a question for you, but is there anything going on nationally? Because I suspect, and tell me if I'm wrong, that lots of people who probably are, north of 50 or significantly north of 50, who could be coming for retirement, are going to find that this magic, £7,500 state pension, it's all over the national newspapers, is not going to be for them. They're going to find themselves actually, £125 a week or somewhere, as opposed to £155. I mean, is anything happening nationally to sort of alert people? I know it's very difficult because, as you said, everyone's circumstances are different, but I suspect some people could get rather a shock.
I suspect that myself because I think the government has promoted the single flat rate pension that every people who are aware, they know that, you know, they were getting this additional state pension to compensate. They weren't getting the additional state pension because they were in the LGPS. So for the likes of all of you realise that, you know, we're not going to get £551 because we're going to get the alternative pension through the LGPS. But a lot of members out there think that we're going to get the
Chair, my apologies in hindsight, I've perhaps declared an interest in this item, but on the specific issue of the single pension, the quality of the information available now on the government website has vastly improved. Mm-hmm. It's very easy to get a projection of what you're likely to be entitled to. And this time last year it was just fog,
yeah.
So there is much clearer information available on the government's website.
Could I ask a question on that? Is it possible for somebody who's opted out of full NI for them to get a lower pension than the old pension was of, what is it?
What do you mean opted out?
They've contracted out.
Yeah.
So could their state pension actually, clearly it would be lower than £150,
yeah.
But could it actually be lower than the old pension level, which is what, £120?
113, isn't it?
113.
You know, because the basics, the contracted out savings don't have any impact on the basic state pension.
Right.
So they will get the basic.
So that's the base.
The base.
As long as everybody's got the full contribution record, albeit
yeah.
That some of those years are contracted out. The 113
is the base.
As long
as they've got some national insurance
right.
Contributions, it doesn't matter that they were contracted out or full contracted.
Yeah.
As long as you've got the full history of, I think it's 30 years under the old state pension, you will get the full
right.
Flat basic.
Because I can still see people who contracted out, it's possible their investment won't give the same rate of return.
Yeah, for the additional state pension,
yeah.
I know, I understand what you're saying, but for the additional state pension where they've contracted out onto a personal pension, where they're thinking, well, they're not going to get the same level what they would have got in the additional state pension, but that additional state pension is on top of the basic state pension, which is £113. So they should have been getting projections on the plans.
We all know the degree of apathy, don't
yeah.
We?
Yeah.
I asked for a forecast because I reach state pension age next year, and because of the contracting out, I probably will be receiving about £90 a week after tax rather than the full state pension. So
you've not got the whole
30
years?
I find that a bit weird, actually.
Did you have a full 30 years of insurance?
I started working in 1969 and I finished in 2010.
So yeah, you have.
So
you should have the full basic state pension.
Yeah.
What would it say after tax?
Well, after tax is 20%, isn't it?
Well, to be honest,
your
state pension is not taxable. It's not. It goes in towards if you've got obviously a private pension. That all gets added together and the whole volume is taxed, but you don't actually pay tax on your state pension.
Oh.
You don't pay tax on the state pension. You will pay the tax through your occupational pension, but your state pension is not taxed.
That's interesting. I automatically assume you put in 20% of that as well.
Yeah. It goes into the whole pot when they say how much your income is, like 25,000 or whatever. It'll go into that, so you tax through your occupational pension, but
yeah.
You have to take.
But in light of the code, don't they? The first thing your code is off the state
yeah.
Pension.
Yeah.
And anything that's left over from the code, they then stick onto occupation.
Yeah.
Yeah. But in my case, and certainly for other people, could we still buy back NI contributions from the employer's side to top your default?
No, to be honest, you'd have to go.
I'll take it up
with that. You'd have to go up onto the DWP.
Yeah.
There is possible, yeah, because as you said, you've left, you've been receiving your LGPS pension before you had your state pension, and this is what it is. For people like you, but it depends on what your gaps are in your. If you've got more than 30 years under the old state pension, I don't know that you are allowed to pension.
Mm.
You've got no gaps in the national insurance.
No.
I had thought that mine would be diluted. I'm not retired for many years, by the way. But in fact, the estimate that I've seen is the full amount because I've been paying. Sure, for the long run, I'm going to confess to.
Yeah. That's it. That was my understanding under the old.
I'll take up my case with them and report back how I get on. That'll be the simplest way. It's sort of like a litmus test.
Just on the interest, you know, you've got the fund, funding level of 86% and then on the SAP, 98%, that's quite a difference. I'm just wondering, is that being shared with employees and are they going to be challenging that? Because, you know, obviously, if the funding level's lower, they'll be expected to contribute more. If I was an employee seeing that, I'd be going,
exactly, but we've explained to your employees through our consultation and through pension committee that 19% is just a benchmark, a standardised benchmark across the LGPS for reporting services, and it doesn't reflect individual funds and individual funds strategies, because that obviously doesn't look at employee profiles, it doesn't look at maturity of funds, it doesn't look at investment strategies.
So like that 86% will like take all that in.
The 86% takes into effect Merseyside's funding levels, it takes into Merseyside's profiles, the maturity of the funds and our actual investment strategy. Now, that's just a standardised health check based across the LGPS for the important bits. Shows how they report, it's called a scheme discount rate, and how the government determine what employee contribution rates are for the funds of pension schemes. So they just want to use that rate across the board.
I mean, the reason they're focusing on that is because I think, for example, that's a lot of the companies again. Previously, amongst the now 88 funds in England, well, it used to be 89, but two of them are like, there were four actuarial firms, and notwithstanding the differences in, you know, maturity and etc., and employees between firms, if you look at those four actuarial firms, you could basically plot a sort of line for each one. There were four distinct lines, and basically, you know, firm A would tend to give you a higher funding level than firm B, and so there was always the issue about these, and then people, some funds say, oh, you know, we're ever so well funded, and others were, oh, we're not having one up so well. And the number of friends was, on that thing, the worst funding in the country. But actually, it isn't, only standardised. So what they then tried to do was try and standardise it, taking out the different approaches of the actuarial firm, all of which are legitimate, by the way, because they're all within, you know, the rules of the Institute of Actuaries, just as accountants will take different views on an accounting treatment. I'm sure if, you know, if Donna and myself, we're given, you know, a set of accounts, we might put different accounting policies in, and we'd both be right. So it was merely on interpretation, but it always clamour came around, and there was lots of issues. So they then tried to use this standardised methodology. As Yvonne has said, really, the standardised methodology is just a little bit of a sort of hint of where people are, sort of. But you cannot take it, because it doesn't take account of individual funds. It's very much a broad brush. There's no fine detail in it. It is helpful.
Just a
guideline. Yeah. It's a bit like a very broad performance indicator with lots of caveats around it.
Are we content to move on?
Peter, on the development.
Yes. A short paper just to really inform the pension board that we do have a programme in place for members of the Pensions Committee. As I say in the report, we're looking to make a number of these opportunities available to pension board members. In particular, looking at the appendix, there's an event in. Sorry, so now looking at page 34. There's an event in June which I propose to make available to all members of the pension board. Unfortunately, it's down in Bournemouth, but it's. I'll circulate details of that to you. We're also, as you're aware, we offered an event in Manchester, and we'll be looking to do that. that are more suitable. But clearly, I need to manage attendance at these things. We can't make them available to everyone, but we're keen for the members to have an opportunity to attend some of these other events. And I think it's probably fair to do it on a pro rata basis if we say children to the pension board can attend these events. You know, we'll offer it to those that haven't had an opportunity if they to reject it. Is that, are you happy with that approach?
Peter, just I assume the PLSA still wedded to NAPA.
Yes.
Trustee conference in October is not on that list.
No, it isn't, and it should be. And I don't know why I haven't put it on the list. But you're quite right, it is in October, it's in Manchester, and I'll certainly be making that available to the whole of the pension board. We're also looking to obviously perhaps put some kind of in-house event together as we have done at the and always open to suggestions which you have had in the past, so if there are things that you're aware of that we haven't either reported to you or whatever, then you're happy to take that on board.
Thank you. Any questions?
That is kind of the foundation, and I'd be keen for people to do that before they do other events, you know, unless they have long-standing involvement in pension schemes. Which most of the board do, so I do take that on board. No, thank you for those comments. It's good our pension committee members find it worthwhile as well. Yes, clearly. Two papers here, the one that we took to September Pensions Committee and the paper taken to January Pensions Committee. In one sense there's little progress to report. The most important things that have happened are that we met with the Minister on the 19th December to discuss our submission, and we received our formal response on the 19th of January. So we'll be publishing that response shortly. It is taking longer to do, but that's just in terms of agreeing a common response between the three funds. But effectively, the letter confirmed that the Minister was happy with the submission that we made in July. He was very pleased with the progress we've made on infrastructure. You'll see that infrastructure is particularly referenced in the two reports that I took in September and January, where we have joined the G-Lil, which is effectively a vehicle for investing either directly or co-investing in infrastructure projects between five LGPS funds at the moment. So we've made a 2% allocation to that vehicle, which is about £125 million, and are working informally with our pooling partners on other areas in which we can collaborate ahead of formal pooling happening in 2018. I think it's fair to say the most important element remains governance, and that's probably the area where we've made the least progress. We have had a shadow joint committee in place for a number of months, and we're looking for that shadow committee to become a formal joint committee, which will effectively, in the same way, oversee the pool and the pooling arrangements. There's a workshop that we're holding at the end of March, which all three funds will be attending along with advisors, in a sense to thrash out some of the fine detail of what it means to operate a regulated investment organisation, and the implications for everyone involved. So I think once we've had that workshop and agreed a way forward, progress will probably be extent that we've invested in GLIL. So GLIL is just investment, it's a limited liability partnership, investing in infrastructure. So we joined the vehicle when there were three existing investments. So we actually have effectively invested in those underlying investments, an investment in a Scottish wind farm, an investment in a fund that's mainly investing in anaerobic digestion plants, and the third investment is in Roman stock. So a number of opportunities. There's quite a good pipeline for 2017-18. There are a number of airports being privatised, so potentially we're interested in those. There's less in terms of regulated utilities, but there are a number of opportunities that we're working on. And we're doing that, say, collaboratively, so that has the advantage of doing it at lower cost, and it also has the advantage that we can invest for the very long term. A lot of the vehicles, infrastructure vehicles, have a limited life. They're long life, 10 years, 15 years, but the investments are made with a view to realising them in due course. As a pension fund, we're actually happy to effectively own and operate, you know, a wind farm for as long as it's in existence. So it has a number of benefits, of course, principally on the cost side.
Yes.
And actually, we've done that collaboratively without actually needing to formally pool. And that is one of the issues, really, that a lot of the benefits of pooling can be realised without the formality of pooling. But clearly the government has its agenda and its policies, and we need to work on that.
How would that fit in if Scotland left the UK?
It shouldn't really make any difference, in the same way as we're invested in investments in Europe or in other parts of the world. It would continue to operate. There might be concerns. Well, in a sense, again, the subsidies are paid by the consumer rather than either by Scottish and Southern Energy or whoever it is. So we're fairly comfortable about the risk.
That's interesting. That's also nationalised. That's okay.
Yes.
Suez Canal alone.
Hence, we have a diversified portfolio.
Yeah.
And it's only one element of our infrastructure investments.
In terms of the governments, would there be an expectation of pension funds of the three pension funds to maybe get together or to do anything around this?
Interesting question. It hasn't been suggested. I think no's probably the answer, but in the sense that the pension board's primary responsibility remains to assist the administering authority. The administering authority's responsibilities effectively remain unchanged in terms of strategic allocation and managing liabilities. So I think no is probably the short answer. Yes, the proposal is that there are three representatives from each fund. There is the chair of each fund, a second elected member, and then there is a member representative. And we have written or are about to write to the branch secretaries of the trade unions, asking them to nominate a member, bearing in mind the criteria that we're setting. So we're setting. So the criteria ideally we'd like is that we'd like a rep from each of the three areas, Merseyside, Greater Manchester and Yorkshire. We'd like the three unions represented, Unison, Unite and GMD. And clearly they need to fulfil the criteria in respect of knowledge and experience and understanding.
They'd have to go through the pensions regulation thing, same as the rest of us.
Yes, it's not as formal as that because there isn't a statutory requirement.
Okay.
But yes, effectively that's
just
in principle that's what we can
demonstrate their knowledge.
Yes.
I mean, I have to say that I was at the recent pension board training event in London, and there was a lot of concern, and actually it was interesting, from trade union representatives in the Borders to Coast board, where I believe that I think there is a concern that there's no members of the representation. That may be the same as some other boards, but there was some discussion about that. I must admit there were some people present who trade union shouldn't be represented, including some former officers, I have to say. Said that I thought they should be represented because it was ridiculous that you shut out the members. If there's nothing to hide, why do you shut people out? Surely you want people, as many people as possible, in there so it's an open forum and people can contribute. And I did actually mention that it's in the public domain that this particular forum was proposing to have trade union reps, which I think the trade union reps from Borders to Coast, they were mainly northern. So I think they were from Teesside,
probably Tyne
and Wear. Tyne and Wear, yes, it was Tyne and Wear. I think they already knew that, but I have to say I did have some sympathy for them because it sounded to me like they were being shot at, and I just couldn't see a reason why. But that's a matter for another pool. But I think it's pleasing from a pension board point of view that the Northern Pool proposes to involve employee reps. Because I can only see a positive.
Cumbria has refused to have two representatives.
Well, Cumbria in that same pool, this is the Borders to Coast pool now. But obviously, it's not the first thing discussed that pool here.
Another one of the boards is one of the trade union representatives have to stand down for whatever reason to be replaced by somebody that's in the trade union.
I certainly think it's a bit of a board point, very positive that Northern Pool is involving members because pension fund exists for members.
I think in fairness, we're fortunate that we have a manageable sized board. If you've got north of 10 funds in your pool, it's just a question about how many people you have on board. But I agree that there has to be some fair representation. Representation will still come through the pension board, the individual funds, and the pension committees of those individual funds, because those funds will remain in place. It is only the investments that we need. But it's clearly a question that remains open and actively discussed.
I this is falling to you?
Yes, this is falling to me. We prepare an annual treasury management strategy and policy. It's prepared under SIPA guidelines, so effectively these guidelines relate to local authorities, but we adopt them as best practice. From our point of view, we're only, in a sense, interested on the asset side, we're not borrowing, so we don't, in a sense, have to concern ourselves about the liability management side. But we have a strategy for two or three reasons. One is it's best practice, there's simple guidance around it, and it's a way of demonstrating that we view our cash management very seriously, although we have a zero allocation to cash in our strategic benchmark. We have to manage cash. We're paying out £20 million a month in pensions, so we always have frictional cash, as it's called, from our investment managers buying and selling shares, from dividends being received, from cash being paid out. So there's cash there, cash we have to manage. So it's around managing counterparty risk. Cash is there. Our focus isn't on maximising the return on our cash, it's on ensuring the security of our capital. Iceland seems a long, long time ago, but we did have a small amount of our cash in two Icelandic institutions. I'm pleased to say that we've recovered more than 90% of that, and with interest. In a sense, we haven't lost from that experience, but it was a salutary lesson that just chasing returns isn't sensible in every part of your portfolio. What's cash there for? It's for paying pensions and for managing movements between investments, and so capital security is paramount, but clearly we do try and manage it in the most efficient and effective way to make sure that we have cash available for expected calls, in addition to the pension payments that we have to make. It's a addition to that, we sort of set out the staff who are responsible for doing that and the qualifications that they have. So happy to answer any questions on that, but it's really just to demonstrate to the board that we have the inspection policy in place and why we do that. It's monitored on a quarterly basis. Quarterly reports to our investment monitoring working party have a improved cash, so these reports are to elected members on a regular basis.
Chair, I just noticed on 2.2 on page with the more rental funds cash flows, I think it's negative, where there was more outflows of pensioners than income from contributions, and how is that managed?
Yes, that's a very important question. The short answer is that doesn't take into account investment income. So we're generating more than £100 million of investment income a year, so that comfortably covers the shortfall, but it doesn't mean that we have to monitor our cash flows very closely. We have to be aware not only of our pension payments, which we can predict, but if we're buying a property or if we're selling something, that we have all those future cash flows built in so that we don't have to realise investments for short notice, possibly at a bad time.
I think all the
sales
with that valuation are when those pay their extra payments of funds in 1 year as well. So that also makes it difficult for cash management. Although it's great to take 1 year to invest, but for the next 2 years it's difficult for them to do pension payments. So it's very balanced to you.
When we ran larger cash balances in the past, it just meant that we did take term deposits out from time to time to lock in better interest rates. But with the way that interest rates are at the moment, we actually find the best rates available effectively for overnight cash with our bank. So no, any sort of interest rate hedging would be done in a sense to our investment strategy rather than in relation to cash.
On page 61, it refers to what the institutional lenders, one of which is all local authorities where there's no limit. Are there any controls in terms of rural council, not the state, but clearly they could have a conflict of interest here in terms of making favourable investments for themselves?
I wouldn't expect us to lend money to rural council, but it's a very fair question. If it isn't specified in the policy, then perhaps it should be.
That was a question that came up for me recently. As a body, are we allowed or not allowed to invest in local authorities?
Yes, we are. There's no reason why.
I said yes, and the board was arguing. He said no. On the same level at in particular committees. So, yeah, I'm pleased we should be answered that for me.
I think Jeff's made a very good point actually that rural council. I must admit, something I've never thought of, but it's blowing the obvious actually when someone thinks it is. You do address these.
Because I don't think there's an issue in terms of lending money to rural council, it's just that if there's a preferential rate given to lending to rural council, that would be the issue. So if they are getting advantageous terms compared to other local authorities. That's in my view.
It's certainly something that's been thought of and addressed. It was probably 8 years ago that the pension fund was required to have a separate bank account from its administering authority. Now, Merseyside always had because of its structure, but particularly the shires, that often wasn't the case. And the grey area was where pension fund balances were combined with local authority balances and lent out, and how that interest was shared. But, as I say, if there's a preferential rate from lending a larger amount, there was more so 7 or 8 years ago than there is today, then that's something DCRU has exercised about and put into the investment regulations. You'll see when we get to the investment strategy statement that there is this requirement that no more than 5% of the pension fund's assets should be invested in the local area. Mm. So that is something that has, in a sense, been explicitly introduced in the new investment regulations and investment. we have that cash, perhaps, as you say, there is a potential conflict there. But no, any lending would be done at arm's length. But
can I just follow up on that question? Because whilst we have separate bank accounts, whilst they're under the same treasury management regime in terms of the council, just some reassurance that there's no possibility that they're with the same banker, and effectively there's a sweep over of accounts overnight. So the overnight monies are invested for all the bank accounts, including the pension fund, and the interest is paid at that point. So is it a completely arm's length separate arrangement, or is it part of a sweep arrangement for all bank accounts, including the pension fund?
No, it's completely arm's length, so that we have a separate treasury management policy from the council. The only thing that we share is our inflows, so we just share the cost of our inflows in terms of advice. We have totally separate policies, totally separate bank accounts, and we lend quite differently as well.
So just for the sake of argument, say for instance we built a building of some kind, an academy, houses or something, we could lease them to the local authority, okay, without causing any problems in that respect?
Yes.
There wouldn't be any... what we should be talking about, conflict of interest, so to speak.
Subject to that 5% limit?
Yes.
But I don't know if there'd be, I say, with local investments, and there have been a number of papers gone to our pensions committee on local investments, we're just conscious of the potential for conflict of interest, so it's something that just needs to be managed very carefully. I'm very comfortable with the arrangements we've put in place that we announced a year ago, the Catalyst Fund, which is a fund focused on investing in the local area, but in a sense, the gatekeepers for that are external advisors to the fund, and they are the ones that sort of effectively provide that assurance to us that any investments they propose to us, you know, fulfil the commercial and other requirements we put in place. So, you know, if Wirral Council offered us the best rate for us to lend money, then it'd be silly for us not to do that. And that lending would be done through a broker anyway, so it is an arm's length transaction in that sense, that there is a financial intermediary in between.
Thank you for that.
Okay.
Thank you, Kinsey. Good, sir. Next item. Business plan.
Yes. The purpose of the business plan, which I've put under Appendix 1, is effectively to